the one God concept, as opposed to polytheism, which is the many God concept. Now, in the book of the coming forth by day and by night, which I do not have with me right now, from this novel, the Egyptian book of the day, which is a novel of the Egyptian, they speak of Africans having a monopolytheism. Right now, let's get to this concept of monotheism, the belief in one God. I will first establish my premise by going to some documented evidence. Page 244 in The Destruction of Black Civilization by Dr. Chancellor Williams. As we speak now on this concept of monotheism, which originated with the African. In short, neither the Hebrews, who were originally Africans, nor any European had to come from outside of Africa and come into Africa and teach these heathenistic niggers about one God. We already knew about the concept of monotheism. No one else knew about it before we did know about it. Let me read to you now a case study of the Kingdom of Cuba in Central Africa that Dr. Williams uses now to demonstrate the manifestation of the concept of monotheism, or the one God, being a permanent doctrine and ideology which moved throughout all of Africa. There was no problem of religious unity in Cuba. It's a kingdom which existed between 568 and 1910 of the Christian era, of the common era in Africa, in Central Africa. There was no problem of religious unity in Cuba because there was no problem of religious conflicts in traditional Africa. He says what? Now this man can say this based on 16 years of field study on the continent. He's not talking about something he heard about or he guessed about. He says, I know this from studying African culture from sea to sea, from sea to shining sea. I know, yes, for a fact. The blacks having a common origin and a common center of civilization, which he calls the heartland, the Kushites and the Kemetans, said that all of our civilizations came out of there, had the same fundamental religious beliefs throughout the continent, just as all of their other basic institutions were similar. The inevitable variations were insignificant when compared with the universal similarity. The Cubans believed, as all Africans believed, in one almighty God, the creator of the universe. There were numerous ways of expressing, listen to that carefully now, there were numerous ways of expressing the one God concept. He might be identified with the sun and called the sun God. I want you to listen to this carefully now. Or as a variation of this, he might be called the sky God. The numerous gods, far from being in conflict with the great God, were a necessary part of his divine plan. His own deputies and emissaries who had direct charge of the various departments of life that concern human needs, the earth, water, illness, health, fertility, planting, harvest, the forest, wars, hunting, fishing, rain, etc. Is he saying here now that we should worship many gods? No. He is saying, just as in the Bible you may find over 1,000 names to express the attributes of Almighty God, in African society there were many ways of expressing the bountiful supply of Almighty God. A man who was a fisherman saw God providing for him in the what? The fish of the sea. So a fish may be his shrine. In the beginning, they did not believe that anything they had made with their own hands out of stone or wood, they could bow down to and could help them. Only rational thinking do you believe in? Which at a point we were removed from our high culture and civilization, and when you see us bowing down to this image and that image and throwing blood at this and throwing, I'm not picking on anybody's religion, and get to sacrificing this and sacrificing, that is not the high culture of the African. That is not the African at his best. And white man, don't tell me you had to come and save me from this. Because you go to church at mass and you eat the body of Jesus and you drink his blood. Now, it's symbolic, but you do it. And even the Hebrews sacrificed the lamb, shedding blood. Now, they go through a whole lot of explanation that blood has to be shed for the redemption of the sins of man. And all. I know they have their way of explaining it. And as I said, I'm not attacking anyone's belief. But I don't shed nothing blood. And that's a child hurting. And I know they, and I'm not arguing that with anyone. They say, well, that's a foreshadow of Christ, which was to come and die as a sacrifice for the sins of the world, personally. And anyone who does accept it, I want all that they have a right to. Personally, I do not. But you do not have to accept my personal opinion either. When I step outside of facts and give you my personal opinion, I'll let you know the difference. But I'm coming back to this, that the Son was not worshipped as God by the angels. They saw it as a manifestation of his sustaining the solar system, because they knew well the solar system. They were the ones who invented the sun. Neither was the moon. Now that we were cut off, we began to bow down to all these things and believe in them as having control over our lives. But that is not us at our best. We had therefore strayed away from that God-likeness, and we had strayed off the path. But that was not all Africa. That was not all Africa, as we are led to believe. That was those who were completely cut off. Those who remained some degree of civilization and society believed in the one God so well they did not even build a temple to him. Wherein today Christians, Muslims, and Jews alike call it the house of God. How do you build a house for something that cannot be contained in a house? You could say this is a house of worship dedicated to. No, these people claim that if you want to meet the Lord, you will have to come from here. Is that not confined, just as a man who confines it in the shrine of a stone and a piece of wood, say, God meets with me at this stone, at this shrine? You're saying now, well, I just made it a little larger, you can go inside of it. But this is where you have to go to meet with him. It's a matter of belief. But don't attack the African and call him a polytheist and a heathen because of his outlook of understanding that the Creator manifested himself in many ways. Now, let me deal with the word God. You will find, even in the Bible, there's a text in John, the 10th chapter, and the 34th verse. It says, I said ye are God. Now, is Jesus saying that the people are Almighty God, the Creator of heaven and earth? No. The word means Lord. That's what it means. And he's saying to them, you should have power. Because that's what a Lord has, power to control your life and your death. God, therefore, when you see him, and we will go on a journey in quest of finding out who these, some of these different gods were and what they represented. Once again, I must state, and I will go into detail, that they were symbols of scientific principles and the explanation and investigation of natural phenomena. What happened is when a friend of mine, Brother Ridley, says, and we will be reading from his work too, he says that Edgar J. Ridley, Jr., he says what happened even with the Africans and with all men is when they began to accept the symbol as reality. And now instead of them understanding this only represents something, like a dollar bill is not wealth. It represents wealth. What is the actual wealth? The what? The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that land is the basic fundamental of all wealth. And the dollar upon which the ink is printed, they both have to come from what? The paper has to come from the land, and the ink has to come from the land. So the wealth is the land. The source tells you that he has you food and the thing, and that paper money is real. The symbol.
So now black folks go around saying, it's not black, it's not white, it's green, it's money. He's caught up in the symbol. Our lifestyle and principles have gone down in us. We do not have the respect and morals we did once possess anymore, because we will do anything for a what? Dollar bill. To get the symbol of power, to get the symbol of wealth. This is what happened in the case of man taking a symbol which represented the power of God being revealed in some aspect and manifestation, and now accepting the symbol as being real. So now they can walk into Catholic churches. Again, I say I'm not attacking anyone's belief except to lose dollar meetings and throw water on us and bow down and kiss the black statue to the feet turned white. And they will next Sunday during Easter, the festival of food, they will pull out. You watch the television or the news, and you will see them in Poland and other places parade up and down the street with a black woman and a black child in her arms. They will kiss it, put money on it, adore it, because they believe that this piece of wood can heal them. This piece of wood in the form of a black woman. The Pope of Rome goes to sleep praying to a black woman. He wakes up in the morning praying to a black woman. It's right over his bed, the cot he sleeps on. I see the sister looking at me. He prays to you before he goes to bed and gets up in the morning. Mary, Mary, Mother of God. Black woman. We'll get into that later. Let it settle a while. Feel good, doesn't it? Let's go to Dr. Williams now, and I am to read Dr. Williams first. I'm to read from The Rebirth of African Civilization. I have to give myself notes so I know where I'm going. This is the first book written by Dr. Williams, by the way, immediately after his 16 years of study, field study in Africa. But the one that became most popular and well known is The Destruction of Black Civilization. It is a well-written work. It is terrible. This is The Rebirth of African Civilization by Dr. Chancellor Williams. We read on page 2. Dr. Williams says, we realized rather early that the first thing to be studied was something that upon the surface seemed to be entirely unrelated to our task. He says, we're now getting ready to study the history and culture of our people on the continent. We're trying to establish if there is some degree of continuity of that culture on the continent. It being such a vast continent of so many different tribes, was there a common thread which ran throughout all of them? Because we don't know of a time when it was ever really a united Africa as such. There's always been such a large continent. But is there something common to all Africans? This was the purpose of my field studies, Dr. Williams says. Said, and when I began to study, I came upon something which at first did not seem to have relevance to the cultural and historical aspect I was seeking to, and social aspect I was seeking to explore. He said, but I couldn't get away from it. And he says, you know what it was? The African religion. For religion turned out to be something more than a subscribed to system of beliefs, but a philosophy and an actual way of living. He said, of all people in the world, religion meant something to the African because it expressed his way of life. To many others, it may be a system of belief, what your doctrinal belief is. To him, it is, what did it make you do? Because it was based on, as I stated before, what? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That what is a test of what you believe. That tests what you believe like nothing else. Not what your doctrinal belief is, not what your philosophical outlook and theological speculation is, but what does it cause you to do in relationship to others in the world? That is the great test, the ultimate test of all religious philosophy, barring none. So Dr. Williams said that first and foremost, religion is key, to study the history of African people, the culture of African people, the science of African people, you must first begin at the study of their religion. That's why we're coming at it from this approach. Like, you have to first, that's why Dr. Ben went in that direction. You have to go through that door to get to all the other doors. We now go to the dynamic role of religion. I'm still on monotheism now, but in order to give you the groundwork and the basis to substantiate the premise, I will keep restating and reiterating throughout the study that the African was the founder of the Bible and the moral principles upon which the Bible and all other holy books are based. I feel I must clearly state my case with documentation. I hope you don't mind. We go back now to Dr. Chancellor Williams. Where did I put it? Here he is, over here. Dr. Chancellor Williams, Destruction of Black Civilization, page 94, 96, and 97. This is going to be an interesting journey right here we're taking. Page 94. Here he's given us some view, some insight on the importance of religion and the concept of relating to God. First of all, I want to mention this. Certainly, I do not believe that Almighty God created any religion. I believe religions are created by men in an effort to try to understand the Creator, and he needs some kind of disciplinary form to keep him in line. That's why it's foolish to argue over the different religions with each other. These are man's creations. Almighty God needs no religion. He knows the end from the beginning. It is man who gets all confused. And what was Adam's religion, if that be the case? What was the first man on earth? In Southern Africa, they call, in Tanzania, they call Nkulukulu. What was his religion? He didn't need one. It was clear to him what his relationship was to the Creator. The more distance man gets from his Creator, the more religions he seems to come up with, trying to find a path back to the most basic and simplest of all things, oneness with the Creator. It now is a lifetime struggle to obtain what originally started out as a matter of fact. We have gotten so far off the path of being one. So it is not the struggle of the religious ideologies. I must keep emphasizing that. Black people have been caused to turn on one another by reason of their different understandings of God. Their different understanding about their religious philosophy, even to the point of shedding blood. So discussing or laying the groundwork established by Dr. Williams of the fact that religion was so important to black folks, and the concept, the one God concept, was so very important to African people. In fact, he says, along with Rogers, it was the impetus which motivated them to build things on such a gargantuan manner, in such a gargantuan manner, huge structures such as you find in ancient Kemet and in ancient Kush, the pyramid which covers a 13-block period, all those things were done on such a large scale because our way of thinking was a large way of thinking. And we had a large way of thinking because we believed that we had direct contact with the creative force at that time. What then happened to the black man who was the creator and founder of the concept of the one God, who established the basic moral systems upon which the Bible and all other religious literature is founded? What took place in Africa to cause a transition and to bring us eventually to where we are today? In The Destruction of Black Civilization, page 120, Dr. Williams says, to make matters worse, from the viewpoint of the blacks, Shishonk, and since I brought his name up, excuse me, I must say who he is. Shishonk, and I will give you the date, was an Asian who ruled in part of Egypt, not all of Egypt, but in the part which was called Lower Egypt, a small section of Egypt there. He was an Asian who, one of the Asian invaders who reigned in Egypt from 947 to 925 before the Christian era. And this is what Shishong did, which was the method used by all other European invaders and those who ruled parts of our homeland. He had another son of his made high priest of the African god Amun. We will discuss the principle of Amun in a future, in one of our future seminars. The significance of this should be obvious. The whites were systematically preempting the whole of Egypt, even adopting as their own black institutions they could not easily destroy. Now, if they could have destroyed the idea and concept of religion in black folks and the concept of godlikeness and oneness with the Creator, they would have done it. But they found they couldn't destroy it. So when they found they couldn't destroy it, they decided to do what? Co-opt it. Even adopting as their own black institutions they could not easily destroy, and they were wise enough to see that to control Africans, you would have to gain control of the African religion. So now as the whites became priests and worshippers of the supreme god and lesser gods of the blacks in Egypt, the success of erasing every vestige of early African civilization was moving toward the absolute. What was the first step in erasing from our minds a knowledge of our greatness and our history? The fact that we even created the Bible or any other sacred literature. What was the first step in doing that? What was it? To co-opt the religion and the religious institution. In short, they took over Africa's gods as their own, as means of taking over Africa as their own. That is why it is so important for us to study religious philosophy from an Afrocentric world of view. In finishing off this second document, the point I wanted to use in concluding that is that the man who established the concepts and morals and of all religions and the people who created the idea of the one God were now a people who have been cut off from that by someone who invaded their land, co-opted their religious institutions, and as a result, in turn, was able to co-opt their what? Their historical institutions, their economic institutions, and all other institutions. So for us as a people to reject religion or spirituality on the basis that it is the white man's thing is historically incorrect. It did not originally belong to him. The concept didn't belong to him. It was born out of us. Now, whether you choose to adapt it or not in your own life is up to you, but you should at least know that it was a creation and a product of your own being, your people, and your ancestry. Document 3, the book containing the collection of sacred writings accepted by Christians as inspired of God and as possessing divine authority. The English word Bible is a transliteration through the Latin and Old French of the Greek Biblia, literally little book. There are several key words in this document here that gives us some light on the Bible. First of all, the Bible is not one book, but what? A collection of books. We presently have 66. It seems as we study it, a lot more. What we're left with now, 66. But it is a collection. It's like a little library within itself. And it is accepted by Christians and Jews as sacred. Not necessarily by other peoples of the world. Because wherever you go in the world, you will find people who have sacred books. You will find the Hindus who have sacred books. You will find in the Kiba Nagas of Ethiopia a sacred book. The Holy Quran is a sacred book. So I think we need to deal with the word sacred. What makes a book sacred and not sacred? The word sacred comes from the Latin word, I have to make sure I find it, sacare. tired, which means to set apart. And you will see on your Bible so often the Holy Bible, and holy comes from the word holy. It's an old English word meaning sacred or set apart. So when you look at the word holy or sacred book, it means that this particular book, in this case the Bible, was set apart from other books as being distinct and better than the rest of those books. But who was it set apart by? It was set apart by the Hebrew people who created the book, the African Hebrews who created it. In the case of the Holy Quran, it was set aside by the people who created that. In the case of the Kitab Nagash, it was set apart by the people who created that. In short, historically, not contending what anyone else believes, but historically, what we come to is that books which are called sacred are those which are chosen and set aside by a what? A people. Determine what is sacred and holy to them, what is the best of their literature, because the word essentially means elevated above all else, the best that they have to offer, sacred and holy. So what right does one group of people have to go to another group of people and say to them, this book which I created and have been inspired to write, because all people say that God came to them and told their prophets to write the book. Now, we have no way to prove nor disprove that. That's a matter of belief. But to go to a man and say, look, this is the inspired book among my people, and in order for you to be saved, or to be a man and not a heathen, you must accept what? My inspired book. So this is a collection of writings which are accepted by Christians and Jews as being sacred. We're neither contesting that or upholding that. We're simply saying this. It is a matter of opinion. One, I do not think that is really up for debate, because you can lose a lot of time and effort on trying to prove that your book is holy. And I've seen people do it. I've seen brother with the Quran and brother with the Bible fighting each other, trying to prove which book is holy and sacred. We've talked about the definition of many sacred writings. Now, the word which comes to us through the old English and the Latin and goes back to the Greek, biblia, is a word which means books. Nothing else. There's no sound of angels singing and a divine light coming from the word. The word means books. And holy and sacred means books set apart from all other books. And the Greek word specifically means what? Little books collected into one. And at first, they were not books as we know books, but I'll get to just how they were put together. Let's go to document 4. We've established several things here in these documents thus far. First of all, that the Bible came from Africa, men in Africa. Can you prove that? Can you back that up? You can't, Brother D. All right. Secondly, we established that the morals and concepts in the Bible, namely the chief moral concept is supposed to be the belief in one God or monotheism, came from Africa. Thirdly, that what is called the Holy Bible is actually a what? Collection of little books. And fourthly, the reason why they are called holy is because what? A people decided that in the context of their historical and cultural experience, what was holy and what is not. Therefore, fifthly, no people have the right to define for any other people what is their what? Sacred and holy book. That, I think you'd have a lot more peace in the world if folk, excuse me, didn't go around trying to convince folk out of their holy book. White people say they took over Africa because they had the book. to take it over. They were trying to teach us the book and took it over. That was their claim. The word Bible in document 4, which in English as in medieval Latin is treated as a singular noun, is in its original Greek form a plural. And he adds to that, ta biblia. The sacred book, which correctly expressed the fact that the sacred writings of Christendom are made up from a number of what? That is the key in the document. We tend to think that the different books of the Bible were written by men and women as they were sitting down taking notes from Almighty God. He said, write this, and they wrote it. And that somewhere along the way, Daniel and Isaiah and them hooked up and said, let's put the Bible. No, it did not happen that way. The first writings that we know of in the Hebrew Bible, which I believe and we can prove came almost intact, so much of it from the Book of the Coming Forth by Day and by Night, misnomer the Egyptian Book of the Dead. They did not even begin to set down a collection of writings for the Hebrew people until about 850 before the Christian era, approximately 850 before the Christian era. Note now, their brother Africans in the land out of which they came had been writing for how long? Huh? What is it? 18,000 years. And had dominated the paper industry for well over 3,000 years. And they now, 1,850 years before the Christian era, began to start writing a collection of their works and putting them together. Well, what did they do before then, Brother Chaka? Prior to that time, they went by oral tradition. So when it came time to put the Bible together, there were several sources they drew from. Oral tradition, mythology, legend, and as much recorded fact as they had access to. And the recorded fact was in the area of statistical information. That's why you'll see a lot of genealogies in the Bible and so forth. 850 is when they began to set down the scripture. That's when the second story in the book of Genesis was written. There's actually two stories about the creation in the book of Genesis, and when we get to that, we will study it very closely. That is the fourth document. We'll move to document 5. What did we establish in the fourth document? And there are a number of independent writings. They were writing without collaboration with one another. And they were writing from their historical and cultural viewpoint at the time of the writing, the principles they were putting into writing. Document 5. The Bible is not one book, but many. Yes, my son. Yeah, it has a continuity of thought because the basic religious ideology and moral structure of the Hebrews, which they inherited from the Egyptians, remained the same. You will find differences of approaches to it, and you will find some contradictory statements simply because these writings were being put down by men. But the principles remain the same. That is the point. Yes. The Bible is not one book but many. The original form and meaning of the word itself bears this out. He gives us another word now, biblo. A Greek word which means book, so called from biblo, spelt with a Y. The inner bark of a, brings us to your point now, brother, the inner bark of a what? Papyrus reed. On which early writings were inscribed. Let me stop in this document right here and say this. the very word itself, Bible, coming from the Greek type Biblia or Biblia, and then finally Biblo, is a derivative of the substance upon which the book was recorded, which in Latin is called papyrus, from which we get the word today, what?
Paper.
But we take it a step further. The Greek name for papyrus was biblos, later book, later given also to manufactured written material, and finally to a papyrus scroll of books. What is your point, Brother Shaka? What are you seeking to arrive at here? This substance, show us the picture now, brother, please.
This substance, which the Greeks call biblos, and the people who spoke Latin called papyrus, was called comma.
By who?
By Africans.
Well, what did Africans have to do with biblos and papyrus? To find biblos and or papyrus, or what was originally called comma, you had to go to the what? You had to go to the Nile River.
The Nile River is where the most abundant papyrus grew. And it was there that man began to develop it into paper.
A very curious thing before I read you something and then show it to you. A very curious thing about this paper upon which you record the Bible and all other books, the invention of the black man, is that you see how that papyrus looks? You see how it is on the picture? Has anyone in here ever studied physiognomy or anatomy? Have you ever seen in your readings or in your passing a picture of the medulla oblongata at the top of the spine, which governs the thought patterns of the brain? If you have ever seen a picture of it, it is identical to that. The nerve endings on the medulla oblongata is identical to that of the papyrus. How did we know that? Unless we were into anatomy and other sciences, which we'll find out if we were. But the curious connection here that I think is so beautiful to show that Africans saw a commonality and a spiritual union of all things, earthly and terrestrial and celestial, all things in common in the cosmos, is that this material, which is used to record that which is produced by man's mind, is a material which itself resembles something in man's mind, which is a governing factor in his thinking process. The Creator is indeed wonderful in his works and how he does things. They would take this papyrus reed, a comma, and they would cut it in half, and it contained its own adhesive. They would cut it into strips, and they would put strips this way, strips that way. Then they would take a smooth stone, smooth it out, and the natural adhesive contained in the comma would bring it together into fiber. And in this, out of this fibrous substance, you would develop a parchment. Then they went to the ground and developed, they went to the burning candle and developed soot. Out of the soot, they developed ink with chemicals they had taken out of the ground. And they would take now either the lotus reed or the comma, and they would use it as a writing instrument. That's how you get paper, ink, and pen, invented in the Nile Valley by your ancestors so many thousand years ago. And I know I'm beating a dead horse, but I must reemphasize the fact that there would be no Bible if we had not done this, for there would be no way of what? Recording it without the system of writing. Writing was so vital to Africans that it was sacred. Not everyone was allowed to write at one time, because just to know how to write was a very sacred and honorable profession. That is why today they call ministers the what? Clergy. Because for years, they were the only ones who knew how to write in Europe. And in Africa, the priests controlled the writing and the writing material. Brother, you had a point or a question on that.
Well, no, it's just that an artist knew that the writing material in Egypt from the early 3rd millennium.
Well, that's as far as they're willing to tell you. But we find books that are 18,000 years old. You must realize that the people who are publishing those books are European, and they go to the limit of their knowledge at the time. The third millennium takes you back to third millennium before the Christian era would take you to about 3,000 years before Christ, 3,000 years before the Christian era. But I'm stating to you that we found evidence which states it's older than that. Yes, it's been... Yeah, writing has been in the world for a very long time. In fact, we do not have a beginning or origin date for it. We just know it was here. People were writing, and we find very old writings. Now, I'm going to African History, page 20, in Ben Sweetling's book again, which I just love to peruse through the book many times and look at the artwork. It's like going through a museum. And he states this. And look very carefully in this picture when you get it. And you will see the reeds being presented to the pharaoh here by one of the scribes. And you will see how that does indeed resemble the medulla oblongata at the base of the brain at the top of the spine. The ancients writ first upon palm leaves when they first started writing on palm leaves. Next, on the inside of the bark of trees from whence the word a liber, a book, is derived. After that, upon tables covered with wax on which the characters were impressed with an instrument called stylus, sharp pointed at one end to write with and flat at the other to efface what had been written. A good performance is not to be expected without many erasures and corrections. So that was one of the first erasures we have. That system of writing was not used very much in Egypt. It was used in Mesopotamia, in the Sumerian Empire, which we'll be studying as we go on, and in the Babylonian Empire. And the system of writing was called cuneiform. Cuneiform. Which was wedge-like writing. But it's the way the position of the wedges. Now, they had an alphabet which came up, I believe, to 24 characters in that alphabet in cuneiform writing. But it was a difficult and cumbersome way to write because you put it in, you had to, with a stylus, cut it into a wax tablet and bake the tablet. The most convenient system, and writing on leaves was all right, but leaves did not have the longevity that they would fall apart as parchment had. Parchment could also keep better there in the land as long as you keep it away from a lot of humidity and moisture. Consequently, that's one of the reasons why the Bible has survived many other books, and you can find scrolls of the Bible around, because of the fact that they carried it around in the desert, the Hebrews, as they were moving, and it was not destroyed by the moisture content that many books were destroyed by as the river began to move further in along the shores of the Nile. At last, the use of paper was introduced, and this was made of the bark of papyrus, divided into thin flakes of leaves, which were very proper for writing. And this papyrus was likewise called bibulus. Pliny, the Roman naturalist, called it a wonderful invention, so useful to life that it preserved the memory of great actions and immortalized those who achieved them. So now we understand why the ancients, Africans, and other peoples as well, looked at writing as being a gift from the gods. From Almighty God, because it was through writing and preserving on paper that you could now immortalize a man. Once you write something, you're immortal. After you leave here, the spirit of your creation is there for the world to see something about you and what you did. That's what made it so sacred and divine. This is where the whole idea, at one time, not just one book was sacred, but how many? All writings were considered to be sacred. So there was an evolutionary process by which we come to setting aside some writings from other writings where you get holy writings and secular writings. It didn't start out like that. All writing was sacred. And above here, you're seeing a picture of the artist's conception of Khufu of the fourth dynasty as the scribes are bringing to him one of their improvements and development on the system of making paper. What did we learn from document 5?
That the material for making paper was grown on the Nile River, most abundant on the Nile River, and ink and pen came from this material as well and from the shores of the Nile, and it was therefore from Africa that we get the writing stuff most efficient and durable, which enabled you now to produce books on a level that could be spread around the rest of the world.